biblical teaching, benefiting those who seek to understand their faith and know God. Ligonier Ministries was established in 1971 and is chaired by noted conference speaker, author, and theologian, Dr. R.C. Sproul. R.C. teaches in a personal way, and with characteristic enthusiasm, he engages his audience with substantive biblical truth. Full of zeal and vitality, Dr. Sproul examines the meaning of holiness and why people are both fascinated and terrified by a holy God. It is a profound investigation into God's character that will lead you to a fresh understanding of sin, justice, and grace. The result is a new awareness of our dependence upon God's mercy and a discovery of His majestic holiness. Charles Colson, chairman of Prison Fellowship in Washington, D.C., says this about the series. By the end of the sixth lecture, I was on my knees, deep in prayer, in awe of God's absolute holiness. Through Sproul's remarkable gift of communication, I came to know God that day in a profound way I had not known Him before. And now, part one.
Our Father and our God, when we approach this subject of your holy character, we know that we are embarking on an impossible task, and that even this moment we are standing upon holy ground, ground that, were it not for your abiding mercy and grace, would open up beneath our feet and swallow us into the pit. And so tonight we ask, nay, we beg you for a double measure of your grace and mercy upon us as we seek to understand these things that are so important to our understanding of you. And we invoke the presence of the Spirit of Truth, who is at the same time the Holy Spirit, that He may assist us in this endeavor. For we ask these things in the name of Christ. Amen. I was a senior in seminary at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary. And it was a fall afternoon, and I remember vividly that I was studying by myself in the library. And I had a stack of books in front of me, and as you know, a library in a theological seminary is a place that is quiet as a morgue. No one is ever allowed to talk or chatter. It's a hushed silence. When suddenly my attention was distracted by this murmuring that started running spontaneously through the stacks and through the open tables in the library, and people began to disrupt the whole atmosphere of the place, and people were leaving their seats and their desks and rushing out into the corridors of the seminary, and I didn't know what was going on until somebody said something out loud that was unmistakable, and they said this: someone has shot the president. You can imagine an announcement like that and what it would do to people's normal daily routines. I rushed outside, and like every other American, I glued myself to the radio and I listened to the moment-to-moment bulletins as President Kennedy was fighting for his life momentarily, and then, of course, the announcement came through that he died. And for the next day, indeed the next weeks, the next month, the people of the United States of America were preoccupied with this tragic moment in our history of the sudden death of a popular president. And then later a book came out that was entitled, Johnny, We Hardly Knew Ye. And it called attention to the fact that his presidential term was indeed brief. But anytime, ladies and gentlemen, that the chief executive, the leader, the king, the prime minister of a nation passes away, it is a time of solemn, serious trauma for the nation. Well, that was true in Israel, as well as in the United States. For in the 8th century, a king came to the throne in Jerusalem and began to reign at 16 years of age, and he reigned in Jerusalem for over 50 years. Imagine it, over half of a century. And he wasn't the most famous king of Jewish history or the most important king of Jewish history, but he would certainly rank in the top five. His name was Uzziah. And what Uzziah accomplished in his reign was to bring the last significant spiritual reform to the people of the land. And when he died, and he died, incidentally, in disgrace because he was sort of a Shakespearean tragic hero who violated his own principles of ethics and spirituality in the last year of his life. But when he died, it sort of signaled a turning point, a watershed in Jewish history, where from that day on, the spiritual life and vibrancy of the Jewish nation went into a serious decline from which it never recovered. I think it's significant in the providence of God that 4 years after Uzziah died, the city of Rome was founded. And a cultural change took place that would shape the whole future destiny of history. But in the midst of that struggle of that nation, a man was called of God to the sacred vocation of being a prophet. And some would call him the greatest prophet in Old Testament history, a man who was not only a religious person, but he also was a statesman in his own right. As he spoke to several kings in the course of his ministry, he was the prophet who said that someday in the future, a virgin would conceive and bring forth a child, and his name would be called Emmanuel. It was the prophet who said that in the future, the servant of the Lord would come and bear the sins of his people. His name, of course, was Isaiah. And the record of his call to the role of the prophet is found in the 6th chapter of the book that bears his name, and I'd like to read the first part of that record for you now. It says in chapter 6 of Isaiah, verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And above him were the seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they were flying. And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And at the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke." Now, I want you to notice in this brief passage that I've read here that Isaiah locates this experience that he has in the year that King Uzziah dies. And we don't know for sure whether what Isaiah beheld was an ecstatic vision that took place in the temple in Jerusalem, or if, in fact, what Isaiah saw was a glimpse into the inner sanctum of heaven itself. I prefer the latter interpretation. I'm persuaded, for technical reasons I won't get into here, is that what happened was that God opened the curtain. He removed the veil from heaven itself. And as John, centuries later, on the Isle of Patmos, would get a glimpse of the interior of heaven, Isaiah the prophet saw the Lord enthroned in heaven itself. Now, if you see in your Bible, you'll see that it says here, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, in the train of his robe filled with temple." If you look At your Bible, you see the word Lord, and I'm sure it's spelled capital L, little O, little R, little D. Is that true in your Bibles there? If you go down a couple of verses to where the song of the seraphim, where it says, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Do you see that? You see that same word Lord is spelled capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. How many of you noticed that in your text? Okay, it's a very common thing we find in English translations of the Bible, and it's not a result of a typographical error, but rather the translators are trying to signal to us that something is going on here that's a bit unusual, that even though the same English word, Lord, is here in the text, the fact that they are printed differently indicates that there are two distinctly different Hebrew words behind the text. Anytime you see capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, you can be fairly confident that the Hebrew term that is being translated is the name Yahweh. The name that God revealed to Moses in the Midianite wilderness when he said, I am who I am. That's the sacred name of God, the holy name of God, Yahweh. Earlier when we see this word Lord, capital L, little O, little R, little D, it translates now a different word, which is the Hebrew term Adon, Adonai. And that is probably the most exalted title that the Old Testament uses for God. He's given many titles in the Old Testament. This is the supreme title that is given to him. We think, for example, in Psalm 8, where we read, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all of the earth. There it's what? O Yahweh, our Adonai, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. And again in Psalm 110, we read this, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit thou at my right hand. A fantastic statement to be found in the Old Testament where David now describes Yahweh talking to someone else and ascribing to that third person the title Adonai, the title that had always been reserved for God himself. It's no accident, ladies and gentlemen, that the most quoted and alluded to Old Testament verse in the New Testament is Psalm 110, where Paul tells us that Jesus is given the name that is above every name, the title Lord, Adonai, the name that originally belongs to God and to God alone. Now, the meaning of the term Adonai simply is this, the sovereign one. So do you see what's happened? The king is dead. There is this time of uncertainty and mourning in the land and the Jewish people. And Isaiah comes in the name of his people, and he looks and beholds into the interior parts of heaven itself, and he sees not Uzziah, not Hezekiah, not David. He sees Adonai, the supreme sovereign enthroned in heaven. I'm convinced personally that what he is seeing here is a pre-incarnate glimpse of the enthronement of Christ himself in his full majesty. He said, I saw the Lord seated on the throne, high, exalted, the train of his robe filled the temple. Oh, I love that phrase, the train of his robe filled the temple. You know, in ancient days, the clothing of monarchs was a measure of their status. An international protocol would respond to the various levels of the magnificence of their clothes. If a king wore ermine, that was incredible. If he wore sable, that was even better. Mink was sort of second or third grade level. And those that came with canvas robes, they had to sit in the back of the summit meetings of the king. I remember seeing one of the first international television broadcasts that was taking place in America was a viewing of the coronation of Queen Elizabeth. And the commentators went on and on about the pomp and the circumstance that only the British can bring to such a celebration. And the magnificence of her gown. As she came to approach the throne in Westminster, she was, and before she went to Buckingham Palace, they had several pages who had to lift the train of her gown as she made her entrance into the Abbey. Because that gown trailed for several feet behind her as she processed. But do you hear what Isaiah is saying here? Is that when he saw this vision of the heavenly king, he saw a king whose splendorous garments billowed out over the sides of the throne and so went on to furl back along the sides of the temple, around the back entranceway, and spilled out and completely filled the entire building. And what he is seeing here is a visual experience of majesty that is focused in the magnificence of the garments. And then he said, over the throne and above Yahweh and Adonai, the Lord, were the seraphim, each with six wings. This is the only reference in Scripture to these creatures who are called seraphim. Some have tried to identify them exactly with the cherubim, but I think since the Bible distinguishes, we need to distinguish them. We know very little about them except that they are part of the heavenly host, those beings that were especially created by God to serve Him day and night in His immediate presence. And if we read the description that Isaiah gives of them, it seems as though they appear in almost bizarre fashion, for we are told that they had six wings. Well, let me just stop here for a second and make a comment. When God creates creatures, He does it with a certain creative economy. He doesn't waste material. He has an amazing, extraordinary ability to create whatever He makes in such a way that it is adaptable and suitable for its environment. God makes fish with gills and with fins because their natural habitat is in the water. He makes birds with wings and feathers because their environment is in the air. And so when He creates angelic beings, whose specific task and function in creation is to minister to Him in His immediate presence, He constructs them in such a way as to make them fit for their environment. And hence we are told they are given two extra sets of wings. With two, they cover their face. Think of it. That these angelic beings minister daily in the immediate, unveiled presence of Almighty God, whose glory is so refulgent, so piercing, that even the angels have to shield themselves from looking directly at His face. Remember the story in the book of Exodus, when Moses, representing the people of God, was summoned by Yahweh to Sinai to receive the law of God. And you remember, Moses went up there into the clouds and was sort of swallowed up on that mountain. And the people waited for days and after days, and they were apprehensive and stricken with anxiety as they wondered what had happened to their leader. Had he been swallowed up by the wrath of God on that mountain like Korah and his people had in the rebellion? Would he return alive? What would the message of God be if he did come back? And so they waited in fear and trembling for Moses' return. And while Moses was on the mountain, he spoke with God. You remember the conversation? If I can improvise a little bit, it went something like this. Moses said to God, he said, God, I have seen some magnificent things in my lifetime. You've shown me the burning bush. I've seen the plagues by which you devastated the Egyptians. I saw you part the sea and bring a whole nation of people through on dry land. I've seen you provide supernatural, miraculous provisions from heaven for us hungry people. But now let me have the big one. God, please, let me see your face. God said, Moses, you know better than that. You know it's my word that no man shall see me and live. You can't see my face, Moses. Here's what I'll do. I'll carve out a little niche in the rock over here, and I'll put you in the cleft of the rock. And then I will cover you, and I will pass by, and I will let you see my backward parts. The Hebrew reads the hindquarters of Yahweh. But my face shall not be seen. So God put his servant in the cleft of the rock. And he allowed his glory to pass by. And ladies and gentlemen, for a split second, Moses got a backward glance of the refracted glory of God. And what happened? When he came down from the mountain, and the people saw this figure approaching in the distance, they became all excited for the return of their leader, and they rushed forward to greet Moses. And suddenly they shrunk back in horror and fell on their faces, and they began to plead with Moses, saying, Moses, Moses, cover your face. They couldn't bear to look at it. Why? Because Moses' face was shining with such radiance and such intensity that it was blinding the people. And what the people were seeing, ladies and gentlemen, think of it, was merely a reflection on a human being's face from a backward, instantaneous glance of the glory of God. The angels themselves must cover their eyes in his presence. And with two wings, we are told, they cover their feet. Now, the Bible doesn't explain to us why it was necessary for the seraphim to cover their feet. I can only guess, and I will venture a guess at this point, and that is that the feet, for angels as well as for men, is the symbol in the Bible of creatureliness. We are told that we are of the earth, earthy, that our feet are of clay. When Moses met God in the Midianite desert and wilderness, what was the first thing God said to him? Moses, Moses, take off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the ground whereon thou standest is holy ground. He asked him to bear his feet, the sign of his creatureliness, the sign of his submission before the Holy One. And so even in heaven, the angels cover the sign of their creatureliness. But as fascinated as I may be, ladies and gentlemen, with the anatomy of the seraphim, these are really minor considerations with the text here. What is really important about this text, as far as I'm concerned, is not the structure of the angels, it's the message of the angels. Listen to what the Bible tells us, that with the two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, the whole earth is full of his glory. I was standing over there before we began this series, and those who are watching it by videotape missed some of the things that we did by way of lead-in, and one of the things that this group of people enjoyed was the singing of the classical church hymn, Holy, Holy, holy. And I was listening to you as you sang that. I cannot hear that hymn without chills running up and down my spine. It is magnificent, isn't it? And I think about the angels and everyone casting down their golden crowns beside the glassy sea. That everything that we have that is worth anything is something we would gladly lay at the feet of the Holy One. And how this church this hymn so triumphantly celebrates the majesty of God. But as I was listening to you sing it, I thought, as beautiful as it sounds, imagine how it would sound sung by a choir of angels. And that's what Isaiah saw. The heavenly host above the throne of God, singing to each other in antiphonal response, a single word repeated over and over and over again, holy, holy, holy. Is the Lord Almighty. Heaven and earth is full of His glory. Now, friends, there's something here in this text that as English-speaking people, we could read 1,000 times and miss every time. There's something very Jewish about this text. In the English language, when we want to call attention to something that's particularly important, to give it emphasis, there are different ways that we can do that in print. We can underline words or italicize them, put them in boldface type, put little quotation marks or brackets around them, or fill the page with exclamation points. Oh, how I hate exclamation points when it's not an exclamation. Even my editors do that. I find it in a final draft. I'll read these things and they'll put exclamation points in sentences that aren't exclamations. And please don't think so poorly of me to think that I don't know any better about the use of exclamation points. They do that, it drives me crazy. But that's what we do with emphasis. Well, the Jews did the same thing. They did all of that, underlined, boldface, italicized, but they had another technique to call attention to something's particular importance. And it was a simple technique of verbal repetition. I think, for example, of the Apostle Paul when he's writing to the Galatians and warning of them of the dangers of departing from the gospel that they had received from Paul. And he said, I say unto you that if anybody preaches unto you any other gospel than that which you've received, even if it's an angel from heaven, let him be anathema, anatema, let him be damned. That's a strong statement that comes from the pen of the Apostle Paul. But he doesn't stop there. He immediately goes on to say, again I say to you, if anyone preaches unto you any other gospel than that which you have received, let him be anathema. Jesus was fond of using this device of repetition to make his points. Now remember, Jesus was a rabbi. That meant that he was a theologian. He had a school, and he had students called disciples or learners who enrolled in his school. And he was a peripatetic rabbi. That meant that he walked around, and as he walked, the disciples literally followed him. When Jesus said, follow me, he meant literally, walk around behind me. And the way they would do it would be this way. The teacher would give his recitation. He would lecture as he walked down the road to Emmaus or wherever. And the disciples would follow along behind him and commit to memory the things that the rabbi taught them. Now, ladies and gentlemen, every teaching that ever came from the lips of Jesus Christ was important. But even our Lord took time to call attention to things that he regarded as being super important. And whenever he would come to a point like that he wanted to make sure his disciples never missed, he would preface his teaching by saying two words. He would say, truly, truly, I say unto you, or the older translation, verily, verily. Actually, what he said was, amen, amen, I say unto you. You recognize that word. It comes directly into English, and we say, all the people said what? Amen. But we say amen after the teacher teaches or after the preacher preaches. And it means it is true, we believe it, and so on. Jesus didn't wait for his disciples to confirm the truthfulness of what he was saying. He started his sermon by saying, amen, amen. That's like the captain of a ship getting on the intercom and saying, now hear this. This is the captain speaking. When Jesus repeated that word, saying it twice, he was underscoring its importance. Ladies and gentlemen, there is only one attribute of God that is ever raised to the third degree of repetition in Scripture. There is only one characteristic of Almighty God that is communicated in the superlative degree from the mouths of angels, where the Bible doesn't simply say that God is holy, or even that he's holy, holy, but that he is holy, holy, holy. The Bible doesn't say that God is mercy, 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 or love, 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 or justice, 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 or wrath, 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 but that he is holy, holy, holy. This is a dimension of God that consumes his very essence. And when it is manifest to Isaiah, we read that at the sound of the voices of the seraphim, the doorposts, the thresholds of the temple itself shook and began to tremble. Do you hear that? Inanimate, lifeless, unintelligible parts of creation in the presence of the manifestation of the holiness of God had the good sense to be moved. How can we, made in his image, be indifferent or apathetic to his majesty? God alone is holy. And what I want to do in this series is to try to describe what that means and what the reaction of Isaiah and other people historically is when the holy appear. Let's pray. Father, we rejoice that something and someone in this unholy universe is not only somewhat but altogether holy, holy, holy. Impart to our hearts the joy of the seraphim for that truth. Amen.
The Holiness of God series is divided into 6 segments. Study curriculum, which enhances the educational value of this series, is available by calling Ligonier Ministries, 1-800-435-4343. In Florida, call 407-834-1633. For more information about Dr. R.C. Sproul and Ligonier Ministries, call 1-800-435-4343. In Florida, 407-834-1633. Or write P.O. Box 7500, Orlando, Florida, 32854. Resource catalogs featuring additional video series, audio cassettes, curriculum, and books are available. Ministries. presents The Holiness of God, Part 2. The Trauma of Holiness.
Not too long ago, a woman from Oakland, California, spoke to me, and she was angry. She was very distressed. And what she said was this. She said that she was angry with her pastor. And I said, well, why are you angry with your pastor? She said, I get the feeling that for some reason my minister every Sunday morning is doing everything that he can to conceal the true identity of God from the congregation. She said, I come to church and I long to have an opportunity to worship, to have my soul experience reverence for God and adoration. She said, but the God that I'm hearing about is a God has been defanged. He's been tamed. He has become innocuous. And she said, I'm sure that the reason the minister does this is because he doesn't want to frighten people by explaining the true character of God. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know how accurate that woman's complaint was, but I know we all have a tendency to soft pedal the biblical portrait of God. And there's a reason for that. The reason is this, that the holiness of God is traumatic to unholy people. And that becomes clear if we look at the rest of the text of Isaiah. We've seen already Isaiah's record of his vision of the holiness of God. And what I'd like to look at now is what happened to Isaiah in response to what he saw. Before I do that, let me make this comment, that in the early chapters of the Institutes of the Christian Religion written by John Calvin, Calvin makes a statement that goes something like this, hence that dread and terror by which holy men of old trembled before God, comma, as Scripture uniformly relates. What Calvin was saying is this, that there is a pattern to human responses to the presence of God in the Scripture. And it seems that the more righteous the person is described, the more he trembles when he enters the immediate presence of God. There is nothing cavalier or casual about the response of Habakkuk when he meets the holy God. Do you remember Habakkuk's complaint where he saw all of the degradation and injustices that were sweeping across the landscape in his homeland? And he was so offended by this that he went up into his watchtower and he complained against God and he said, God, you are so holy that you can't even behold iniquity. How can you stand by and let all of these things come to pass? And he said, I'm going to sit up here and I'm going to wait until God answers my question. And you remember what happened? That when God appeared to Habakkuk, he said, my lips quivered, my belly trembled, and rottenness entered into my bone. What happened to Job? When he waited for the voice of God, and when God showed himself to Job, Job said, I abhor myself. I repent in dust and ashes. I have spoken once. I'll speak no more. I will take my hand and put it upon my mouth. As Calvin said, the uniform report of sacred Scripture is that every human being, whoever is exposed to the holiness of God, trembles in his presence. That was no less true of Isaiah. Now think of Isaiah. I haven't made a moral survey of 8th century Israel, but I can't imagine that there was any human being running around in the Jewish nation at that time who, humanly speaking, was more righteous than Isaiah. Isaiah was about as righteous as human beings could be found in those days. And he has this glimpse of the holiness of God, and the first thing he does when he sees the holiness of God is that he cries out in terror, and the old King James Version records his words as saying this, "Woe is me, for I am undone." Now I know that more recent translations have tried to change the language there of Isaiah, because nobody talks like that anymore. Nobody says, "Woe is me." The word's kind of antiquated. The expression is an archaism. It's like somebody saying, "Forsooth," or "Alas," and "Alack." Nobody talks that way, unless you have some Jewish friends. Sometimes when things go wrong, they'll say, "Oy vey is near," which is the Yiddish rendition of the same verbiage here, "Woe is me." But for the most part, we don't hear people talk like that in our culture. And so translators, in trying to communicate the Word of God in modern verbiage, will do away with some of this archaic language. But when we do that, sadly, we're in danger of missing another one of those semi-hidden gems of biblical literature. There is a reason why Isaiah used the word woe. In the Old Testament, a prophet was a human being who was anointed by God to be a spokesman for God. The simple definition that distinguished the prophet from the priest in Israel was this, that it was the task of the priest to speak to God in behalf of the people. It was the task of the prophet to speak to the people in behalf of God. So that when the prophet uttered his message, he wouldn't preface his statement by saying, "In my humble opinion," or "It is my judgment that," or "I think that perhaps this may be the case." That's not how they addressed the people. You know what they did. When they gave their message, they prefaced their words by saying what? "Thus saith the Lord." Because they understood that they were vessels of divine announcements. Now again, the literary form that was common to the prophet of Israel was the form that we call the oracle. You've heard, I'm sure, of a Greek oracle, the Oracle of Delphi, who would give these announcements about the future. Well, among the Jews, the oracular literary device, the oracle, was of two types. There were oracles of weal and oracles of woe. Now, that means simply this, that there were announcements that came from God that were good news, and there are announcements that came from God that were bad news. An oracle of weal or an oracle of prosperity used a word that was important to this oracle among the Jews to introduce the good news, and it was the word blessed. Jesus obviously uses the form of the oracle self-consciously as a prophet when he gives the Sermon on the Mount. The people of his day would have recognized the significance of his giving this list of sayings that he would say, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Blessed are the pure in heart, and so on. Blessed are the peacemakers. He was pronouncing the oracle of God's will upon the people. The divine blessing, the divine benediction to those who did these certain things. But the flip side of the oracle of weal was the oracle of woe, which was a grim and terrifying announcement of God's judgment. Here the prophet Amos, when he announces the judgment of God upon the nations and upon the cities, for three transgressions and four Damascus, woe unto you. Jesus, when he gave his scathing denunciation of the Pharisees, prefaced his words of judgment using the Old Testament prophetic oracle by saying, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You cross land and sea to make one convert. Once you've made him, you make him twice the child of hell than you are yourself. I mentioned in our first session how rare it is in all of Scripture for anything to be raised to the repetitive level of the superlative. And I said the only attribute of God that's ever repeated to the third degree is the attribute of holiness, holy, holy, holy. But it's not the only thing that is repeated to the third degree. Jeremiah the prophet, when he went and gave the judgment of God before the temple of the Jews, he said to them, you people come here and you say, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. Jeremiah was saying, in effect, your hypocrisy is to the nth degree. You trust in lying words, words that cannot profit. And the darkest hour of this planet is foretold to us in the apocalypse of the New Testament, where we are told that in that last hour, the bowls of divine wrath will be poured out upon this planet. And we hear of this heavenly figure flying across the darkened sky, announcing the final judgment of God with the repetition of one word, singing what? Woe, woe, woe. You don't want to be around when that bird starts to sing. Do you see what happens here in the sixth chapter of Isaiah? That one who is called of God and set apart, whose words, the very words of God, are placed in his mouth, the first oracle that he pronounces is an oracle of doom upon himself. Woe is me! As soon as Isaiah sees the unveiled holiness of God, for the first time in Isaiah's life, he understands who God is. And the very second that Isaiah understood who God was, for the first time in his life, he understood who Isaiah was. And what came out of his mouth was something akin to a primordial scream, where he curses himself. Woe is me, for I am undone. I know the more modern translations use, for I am ruined. But I like this old one, undone, for this reason. If we look at what's happening here through the glasses of modern psychoanalysis, we could describe this experience that Isaiah relates as an experience of psychological disintegration. That is disintegration. We use words to describe a person who is healthy. We say that that person is whole. He has everything together. And when we see somebody who is losing it, we say what? He's falling apart. Isn't it interesting that a synonym that we use for virtue in our language is the word integrity? That is, that we have everything about our lives meshed together in a coherent and a consistent way. Now, ladies and gentlemen, here is the man who possesses the most integrity of the Jewish people, who comes and gets one glimpse of the holiness of God, and he immediately suffers disintegration. He comes apart. That's what happens to people who catch a glimpse of the character of God. Because do you see that we spend our entire lives veiling ourselves from the true character of God? Because our natural bent, our natural inclination, beloved, is to hide ourselves from Him. Because we know instinctively that as soon as the Holy appears, it exposes and reveals anything and anyone who is not holy by virtue of that standard. We have a justification for every sin that we commit. We are masters of self-deceit. Calvin makes this statement. He said, as long as our gaze is fixed on the ground, we're safe. We flatter ourselves. We address ourselves as demigods, slightly lower than eternal deity. We do what the Apostle Paul warned us not to do when he said, those who judge themselves by themselves and judge themselves among themselves are not wise. Let me tell you something about human nature. We could go out into the streets of America and ask this question to everyone on the street, and I can't believe how many people would answer it the same way. If I said to people, are you perfect? I'd be willing to bet that 99 out of the 100 people that we ask that question, no matter what their background is, would say, no, I'm not perfect. The one axiom that all Americans will vote for is that nobody's perfect. Errare humanum est. To err is human. Nobody's perfect. But that doesn't seem to bother us at all. There's not one person in 1,000 who will deny that they're not perfect. That's a double negative. Let me put it the other way. There's not one person in 1,000 who will claim to be perfect. And beloved, there's not one person in 1,000 who understands the seriousness of not being perfect. Because the standard by which we will be judged ultimately is not a curve, but it will be the standard of God's perfection. Now I hear this, everybody's entitled to one mistake. Says who? Where did God ever say you can all have one mistake? One free sin. One free act of treason against my authority. One free insult to my integrity. He never said that, did he? But even if he did, how long ago did you use yours up? Everybody's entitled to one mistake. I hope we get more than one. One mistake a second is more like it. But you see, we're comfortable with our imperfection. We judge ourselves by each other. No matter how ashamed I may be of the weaknesses in my life, and sometimes when I look inside myself, I make myself sick. Don't you feel like that? Do you ever disgust yourself? Say, how could I do that? I can't believe that I'm that selfish, or I can't believe that I'm that covetous or lustful or whatever it is. Yeah. But we are quick to excuse ourselves because we look around and we can always find somebody who's more depraved than we are, at least on the surface. So we can be like the public or the Pharisee that Jesus talked about that went up to the temple to pray and said, oh God, I thank you that I'm not like that miserable guy over there. And so we find a way to excuse ourselves and to flatter ourselves until we see the standard. And when that happens, we are undone. As Isaiah was undone, when he saw pure holiness, he understood what it was that he wasn't. He couldn't stand it, and he's on his face, and he's screaming out in pain, and he's saying, woe is me, for I am undone, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. I wonder why he said what he said. When he cries out now in his terror, he said, I'm undone because I have a dirty mouth. Wonder why it went to his mouth. If you read the teaching of Jesus, one of the things that comes through his teaching again and again is a lesson that almost no one in the 20th century believes anymore. Jesus, if Jesus of Nazareth taught anything, he taught repeatedly that someday every human being would be called before the tribunal of God. That every one of us will have to give an account before the holy creator of heaven and earth. And Jesus says that on that day, every idle word that we have ever spoken will be brought into the judgment. That everything that we've ever done, everything that we've ever said, every promise we've ever made and broken, every blasphemous statement that's come from our mouth, every slanderous word that we've made towards our neighbor will be brought up on the table. Jesus said, it's not what goes into a man's mouth that defiles a man, it's what comes out. God has given us our mouths as vehicles to praise him, to express his truth. And instead we've used our mouths to lie, to hurt other people, to blaspheme God. We have dirty mouths. When Isaiah saw the holiness of God, his hand went instinctively to his mouth as he cried out this curse upon himself. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what did God do? Did God look down from the throne and see his servant writhing in the dust in all of this remorse and repentance like some medieval monk in a monastery? Involved in self-flagellation and say, come now, Isaiah. You're taking yourself far too seriously. Don't have such a morbid preoccupation with your own guilt. You're going to give a lifetime of study for the likes of Sigmund Freud carrying on like this. Don't be so neurotic. You've got a guilt hang up. I mean, you must have been reading Jonathan Edwards or anticipating Queen Victoria. That's not what he did. Nor did God look at his servant writhing in the dirt and say to him, suffer. You miserable creep. You deserve to be undone and ruined. Go ahead. Let the curse fall upon yourself. I've had it with the likes of you, Isaiah. I'll catch you later. That's not what he did. Tell you something else he didn't do, ladies and gentlemen. God didn't say a word to Isaiah about cheap grace. God didn't say, look, Isaiah, all I want you to do is sign your name on a membership card or raise your hand and you can come into my kingdom. No. God saw his servant in pain and he nodded to one of the seraphim, and the seraph went over to the altar where the white hot coals were burning there in the holy place, and the coals were so hot that even the angel's flesh couldn't come in contact with them. He had to use tongs, and with these tongs he took one of these white hot coals and he flew over to Isaiah, and we read in the text that he placed this hot coal on his lips. You know how sensitive the human lips are? It's with our lips that we express one of the most intimate forms of tactile communication, the kiss. The nerve endings of the lips are hypersensitive. And yet this man has the experience of having a hot coal placed right on his lips. You know that what happened is the instant that coal touched his lips, there was a huge blister formed on him. You could hear his flesh sizzling. Why? Because God was being cruel and unusual in his punishment of Isaiah? No. The coal was applied to cauterize his lips, to purify him, to heal them, to prepare them for the message that he was to give. Listen to what it says. One of the seraph flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar, and with it he touched my mouth, and he said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." I'm a Protestant by conviction, but one of the things that I miss from the Roman Catholic tradition is the confessional. Yes, the confessional was at the heart of the Protestant controversy, but only one element of it, and we have a tendency to throw the baby out with the bathwater. How I long to be able to go someplace to someone that I can see and hear and experience their real presence and say, "Father, I have sinned. This is what I have done," and list my transgressions, get them off my chest, and then be able to get on my knees and hear somebody say to me, in the name of Jesus Christ, "Te absolvo. I absolve you. Your sins are forgiven." How would you like to hear Christ come in this room right now and walk to where you are privately and say to you, "I know about every one of your sins, but right now, I want to tell you that every sin that you've ever committed in your life is forgiven. Your guilt is taken away, all of it. You never again have to worry about the sins that you have committed against God. I am forgiving you and cleansing you this moment and forever." What would you give to hear Jesus say that to you? That's what God said to Isaiah. It's gone, Isaiah. All of your guilt. You don't have to speak the curse any longer. I'm taking it away. Your sins are forgiven. They are atoned for. And now as Isaiah is trying to deal with that, God speaks once more, and he said, "Whom shall I send, and who shall go for us?" And the first thing that Isaiah says after cursing himself is what? "Here am I. Send me." Notice he didn't say, "Here I am." That would be telling God his geographical location. No, he said, God, here am I. He could hardly say it through these lips. Ladies and gentlemen, the price of repentance is very, very painful. True repentance is honest before God. And to come into the presence of a holy God is a painful thing. But when we come humbly, as Isaiah did, when we come on our face, God is ready to forgive, to cleanse, and to send the only justification for any missionary's mission, for any preacher's preaching, is that that person has experienced the forgiveness of God. Let's pray. Father, we also have dirty mouths, and we could not possibly survive in your presence were it not for the atonement that you have made for us in Christ. We pray that we might know your forgiveness now and forevermore, that we might say to you, here am I, send me. Amen.
For more information about Dr. R.C. Sproul and Ligonier Ministries, call 1-800-435-4343. In Florida, 407-834-1633. Or write P.O. Box 7500, Orlando, Florida, 32854. Resource catalogs featuring additional video series, audio cassettes, curriculum, and books are available. An authority over us and his revealed will for us. Ligonier Ministries is helping to renew the minds of serious adult Christian laypeople and clergy with solid biblical teaching, benefiting those who seek to understand their faith and know God. Ligonier Ministries was established in 1971 and is chaired by noted conference speaker, author, and theologian, Dr. R.C. Sproul. R.C. teaches in a personal way, and with characteristic enthusiasm, he engages his audience with substantive biblical truth. Full of zeal and vitality, Dr. Sproul examines the meaning of holiness and why people are both fascinated and terrified by a holy God. It is a profound investigation into God's character that will lead you to a fresh understanding of sin, justice, and grace. The result is a new awareness of our dependence upon God's mercy and a discovery of his majestic holiness. Charles Colson, chairman of Prison Fellowship in Washington, D.C., says this about the series. By the end of the sixth lecture, I was on my knees, deep in prayer, in awe of God's absolute holiness. Through Sproul's remarkable gift of communication, I came to know God that day in a profound way I had not known him before. Ligonier Ministries presents The Holiness of God, Part 3, Holiness and Justice.
If we look at the period of the 18th century in the American frontier, we notice that there was a recurring motif during the Great Awakening in the preaching that was found at that time, and there was a sort of a dual emphasis. On the one hand, the message of the preachers was that man is very, very, very bad, and that God is very, very, very mad. In other words, there was such an emphasis on the sinfulness of man and the wrath of God that almost what some have called a scare theology that dominated that period. And then in the 19th century, we saw a dramatic reaction against that kind of accent in preaching, so that now the message was, well, man's not quite so bad, and God's not really quite so mad. And there the emphasis was upon the love of God and the goodness of man. Well, at the turn of this century, the beginning of the 20th century, there was a response to that reaction on the continent in the world of theology with the advent of a theology called crisis theology. And it was called crisis theology because it borrowed the term from the Greek word krisis, which means judgment. And these theologians on the continent said that if we're going to take seriously the biblical portrait of God, we must once again take seriously what the Bible says about the wrath of God. Now, there were some extremists in that group who said that what we see in the Scriptures, particularly in the Old Testament at certain times and places, is an expression of something that is irrational in the character of God Himself. In other words, they said this: yes, we do see unavoidably and unmistakably a manifestation of the anger of God in the pages of the Old Testament. But that anger is not so much a manifestation of God's righteousness or of His holiness as it is a manifestation of a defect within God's own character. Believe it or not, I've read some theologians that speak about the shadow side of Yahweh, saying that there resides within God the element of the demonic. And this demonic aspect of God shows itself, displays itself by sudden, unprovoked manifestations of a whimsical, capricious, arbitrary anger. Some of the passages that are in view would include a narrative that we read in the book of Leviticus, which I'll read briefly for you. At the beginning of the 10th chapter of Leviticus, we read this account. Now, Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, took their censers and put fire in them and added incense, and they offered unauthorized fire before the Lord, contrary to His command. So fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. Now, in this understated, terse description of the death of the sons of Aaron, it seems to indicate for us an example of this swift and capricious manifestation of God's wrath. When I read this, I try to read between the lines, and I ask myself, how did Aaron react to all of this? Imagine it. You remember earlier in the Scriptures the elaborate ceremony that God ordained when He consecrated Aaron as the high priest of Israel. How God ordered the minute details of the design of the garments that were to be worn by the high priest, that were designed for glory and for beauty. And then we can imagine how Aaron felt when he saw his own sons consecrated to the priesthood. And here are these young priests who they do something that we're not exactly sure what it was, but somehow they came to the altar and they did as young clergy will often do, try a little experimentation, innovation, play little almost adolescent type pranks as they're fooling around in their job and in a sense of immaturity, and without warning and without rebuke, as they offer this strange fire in the altar, wham, God strikes them dead instantly. Can you hear Aaron? He goes to Moses and he says, what's going on here? What kind of a God is it that we serve? I'm devoting my entire life to the ministry and to the service of Yahweh, and what are the thanks that I get? Like that, he takes my sons for a small transgression. What kind of a God is this? Listen to what Moses said. Moses then said to Aaron, this is what the Lord spoke of when he said, among those who approach me, I will be regarded as holy. And in the sight of all of the people, I will be honored. And then we read these words. And Aaron held his peace. You better believe Aaron held his peace. When the Almighty comes down and said, look, Aaron, I know that this is crushing to you that I have taken the lives of your sons, but do you remember when I established the priesthood? Do you remember the day I set you apart and consecrated you for that holy task? That I said that there are certain principles I will not negotiate with my priests. I will be regarded as holy by anyone who dares to presume to minister in my name. And before the people, I will be treated with reverence. And when God spoke, Aaron shut up. But there are other occasions like that, aren't there? One of the most blood-curdling stories in the Old Testament is the story of Uzzah the Kohathite. You all know the story of Uzzah. You tell it to your fuzzy Uzzah. No, that's about a bear. You know? It's the story of the transfer of the Ark of the Covenant. Remember, the Ark of the Covenant was the throne of God. It was the most sacred vessel in the Holy of Holies. And it had fallen into the hands of the Philistines, and then through a series of amazing incidences, it had been returned to the Jewish people and kept in safekeeping for a while until it was the appropriate time had come to pass for the Ark of the Covenant to be restored to its place in the sanctuary. And David ordered a celebration and called for the Ark of the Covenant to be transferred into the city. And the people lined the streets and they danced and they sang as they moved and saw the procession of God's throne before them. And we are told that the Ark of the Covenant was transported by virtue of being placed in an ox cart. And the Bible tells us that as the cart was moving down the road, the Kohathites were walking along beside it, protecting it, watching over it, one whose name was Uzzah. And in the midst of the procession, suddenly one of the oxen stumbled, and the cart began to teeter and to tilt, and it looked as if this holy vessel of Israel was about to slide from the ox cart and fall into the mud and be desecrated. And so instinctively, involuntarily, Uzzah stretched forth his hand to steady the ark, to make sure that this throne of God would not fall into the mud. And what happened? The heavens opened, and a voice came down saying, "Thank you, Uzzah." No. As soon as Uzzah touched the holy ark of God, God struck him dead. I remember reading a Sunday school curriculum in one of the denominations I used to work with. Came from our headquarters, and I looked at passages like this, and it said, "Now, we understand that these kinds of stories that we read in the Old Testament, like Uzzah and Nadab, like God's destroying the whole world with a flood, men, women, and children, of God's ordering the harem, telling the Jewish people to go into the land of Canaan and to slaughter all of the inhabitants of Canaan, men, women, and children, that this can't possibly be a manifestation of the real character of God, but we have to understand these stories in the Old Testament simply as ancient, primitive, pre-scientific, semi-nomadic Jewish people who interpreted the events that they saw in light of their own peculiar theology. Probably what happened was that Uzzah had a heart attack and he died, and the Jewish writer attributed the cause of his death to an unmerciful expression of this vicious wrath of God. In other words, it was unthinkable to the authors of this curriculum that God himself could actually have anything to do with the death of Uzzah. Yet if we look carefully at the Old Testament and see the history of the Kohathites, I think the answer is made apparent to us. You remember that in the Old Testament, that the 12 tribes of Israel were given certain tasks and certain allotments of the land, and the tribe of Levi was set apart from God as the family that would be responsible for the priesthood and the matters of this, of the temple and of education and so on. And Levi was the tribe, and within that tribe of Levi, there were certain other major families, and each family was given a particular task. Now, Kohath was one of the sons of Levi. And the family of Kohath were separated by God for a specific task. Their job, their whole reason for being, their life's vocation was to take care of the sacred vessels. And they were trained and disciplined from children with all of the prescriptions and the meticulous details of the law of God about how these sacred objects and vessels were to be treated. And the one absolute non-negotiable principle that every Kohathite had drummed into him from the time he was a child was this: never, 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 ever touch the throne of God. And God said, if you touch it, you die. First place, we wonder why in the world the ark was being transported in an ox cart. It was to be transported on foot. There were loops at the edge of the throne through which staves were inserted to make sure that no human hand touched that throne. But instead they were in a hurry and they put it in the ox cart and they're going down, and Uzzah did the unthinkable. He touched the throne of God. But we say, so wait a minute. Why did he do it? His motive was pure. He was trying to preserve the throne of God from being desecrated by the mud. But the presumptuous sin of Uzzah was this, ladies and gentlemen. He assumed that his hands were less polluted than the dirt. There was nothing about the earth that would desecrate the throne of God. The earth was lying there on the ground doing what God has called earth to do, being dirt, turning to dust when it's dry and turning to mud when it's mixed with water. It obeys the laws of God day in and day out, doing exactly what dirt is supposed to do. There's nothing defiling about the earth. It was the hand of man that God said, I don't want on this throne. In a word, Uzzah broke the law of God, and God killed him. But still it seems, doesn't it, that this is a manifestation of cruel and unusual punishment. If you look, for example, in the Pentateuch and see the list of capital crimes that are set forth in Israel, there are over 30 offenses for which God commanded the death penalty among the Jews. Not only for first-degree murder, but for homosexual acts, for adultery. If a child was unruly in public and sassed his parents, he could be put to death. It was a capital crime for a Jewish person to go to a fortune teller. Over 30 offenses God ordained that people should be killed. And again, the theologians look at that and they say, how primitive, how bloodthirsty, how severe. That can't possibly be the word of God, particularly in light of the New Testament spirit of mercy and love. You know, one of the fascinating chapters or footnotes of church history is the historical incident that provoked the formal compilation of the Bible as the canon of sacred scripture. Remember, this is a book that's made up of many separate books, 20-some books in the New Testament. These individual epistles and gospels that were written very early were circulated in the early church and were recognized as scripture and functioned as scripture, but nobody bothered to put them together in one binding and said, this is the Bible, until a man by the name of Marcion came along and produced the first formal edition of the Bible, the first canon of Holy Scripture. It was a very strange canon. The Old Testament was absent, and most of the gospel materials was absent, and just a few remarks from the Apostle Paul were comprised in this canon, because Marcion's working principle was this, that any reference to the God of the Old Testament, Jehovah, couldn't possibly be sacred scripture, because Jesus in the New Testament reveals a different deity from that explosive, hot-tempered, ill-willed deity that thunders from Sinai in the Old Testament. Have you ever wondered about that? I hear it today all the time. There are Marcions all over the place saying to me, well, I like the New Testament, but that God of the Old Testament is more than I can handle. When we compare the Old Testament to the Old Testament seems severe. I've had help in dealing with this from the writings of a very important theologian who's very controversial in the Roman Catholic Church. His name is Hans Kuhn. In one of his earlier and most important writings, written in German under the title Rechtfertigung, translated in English under the title Justification, Dr. Kuhn deals with this very question of the seeming injustice of God's wrath that we find in Scripture, particularly in the Old Testament. And he makes this point. He said, you know, the real mystery of iniquity, the real puzzle is not that a holy and righteous God should exercise justice. What is mysterious about a holy creator punishing willfully disobedient creatures? He said, the real mystery is why God, through generation after generation after generation, tolerates rebellious creatures who commit cosmic treason against his authority. Did you ever think of it like that? And Kuhn goes on to say this. He said, remember that even though there are 30-some capital offenses in the Old Testament, that doesn't represent a cruel and unusual form of justice at the hands of God, it already represents a massive reduction in the number of capital crimes. He said, remember the rules that were set forth at creation. When God, the omnipotent ruler of heaven and earth, breathed into dirt the breath of life and shaped a creature in his own image and gave that creature the highest status in this planet and the greatest blessing and gift that he owed them not at all, the very gift of life, and stamped his holy image on that piece of dirt. Gave them life. He said, the soul that sins shall die. All sin was viewed in creation as a capital offense. And not that the punishment would be death sometime after you've had your 70. But what are the terms of creation? The day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Now, I know people look at that and they say that what the text is saying there is that the day the transgression takes place, we suffer spiritual death. That's not what God said. That may be true, that man suffered spiritual death the day he transgressed the law of God. But the terms of creation were, the day that you eat, you die, biologically. It's over. Now, is there anyone who could convict a holy, perfectly righteous creator who out of sheer mercy creates a creature, gives him all of this blessing? Is there anything wrong with that God extinguishing a creature who has the audacity to challenge God's authority to rule his creation? Have you ever stopped to consider what is involved in the slightest sin? In the slightest sin, beloved, I am saying that my will has a right that is higher than the rights of God. It terrifies me in our culture that people do things like abortion and say they have the moral right to do it. If I know anything about God, I know God never has given anyone the moral right to do something like that. And I shudder to think of what will happen when a person stands before God and said, I had the right to do that. Where did you get that right? In the slightest sin, never mind a heinous sin like abortion, in the slightest sin, what we would call a peccadillo, in that thing, I defy the authority of God. I insult the majesty of God. I challenge the justice of God. But we are so accustomed to doing that and so careful to justify our disobedience that we have become recalcitrant in our hearts. Our consciences have been seared, and we think it no serious matter to disobey the King of the universe. I call it cosmic treason. But what God did was this, as Dr. Kung points out, he says, that instead of destroying mankind in the moment of that act of revolt and rebellion against God's authority, God reached forth and extended his mercy. Instead of justice, he poured out his grace. And the history of the Old Testament, beloved, is the history of repeated episodes of the manifestations of God's gracious forbearance and merciful forgiveness towards a people who disobey him day in and day out. And Kung speculates. He said, I granted, I don't know the secret counsel of God. I can't read the deity's mind. But he said, I wonder if what it is that why we find periodically in Scripture this swift and sudden exercise of justice. Perhaps God finds it necessary to interrupt his normal pattern of long-suffering, forbearing, grace, and mercy to remind us of his justice. He himself complains that his forbearing mercy is designed to give us time to repent. But instead of repenting, we exploit it. And we come to think that God doesn't care if we sin, or even if he does care, there's nothing he can do about it. I saw a young man once defy God, screaming to the heavens, if you're up there, strike me dead. Challenging the Almighty like that. I didn't want to look, but I saw his dead body the next day, and I'll never forget it. But ladies and gentlemen, we become so accustomed to God's normal patterns of grace and mercy that we not only begin to take it for granted, we begin to assume it, we begin to demand it, and then if we don't get it, we're furious. This morning I spoke at Dallas Theological Seminary. I spoke from a passage on the New Testament where Jesus spoke to this very theme, and I used my favorite illustration of this. When I was a young college teacher, I had the task of teaching 250 freshmen in a college, introduction to the Old Testament. And on the first day of class, I had to give out the assignments, and I had to be very careful about what the requirements were because they'll twist them any way they can to get out from them. And I said, look, we have just a few little term papers here, 3 to 5 pages or 2 to 4 pages, with short little papers. I said, 4 of them, if you don't turn them in on time, you get an F for the assignment, unless you're confined in the infirmary or a death in the immediate family. Had to spell that out loud for them. So does everybody understand? Oh, yes, we agree. The first one's due September the 30th. September the 30th, 225 students diligently came forward with their term papers. 25 of the students were standing there shivering and shaking in fear, and they said, oh, Dr. Sproul, we didn't get our papers done. We didn't budget our time. We didn't make the transition from high school to college. Please, give us a chadong, give us an F. Let us have a couple of days extension. I said, okay. I said, I'll let you have it this time, but don't let it happen again. Now remember now, next month, I want those papers here in time. October 30th came, 200 students came with their term paper. 50 of them don't have their term paper. So where's your term papers? They said, oh, professor, everybody's term papers were due this week, and this week was homecoming, and we were busy with floats and all that stuff, and please give us one more chance. And I said, okay, I'll give you a 2-day extension. And you know what happened? They began to sing spontaneously, we love you, Prof. Sproul. Oh, yes, we do. I was the most popular professor on campus until November the 30th. November the 30th, 150 students came with their term paper. The other 100 walked in like they were going down the street for a loaf of bread. They were casual, relaxed, came in. I said, Johnson. He said, yes, sir. I said, where's your term paper? He said, hey, prof, you know? Don't worry about it. I'll have it for you in a couple days. And I took out the black book. I said, Johnson. He said, yes. I said, F. Ewald, where's your paper? I don't have it, sir. I said, F. Cunningham, F. About that time, somebody in the back of the room shouted out, you can guess what they shouted, what? That's not fair. Patrick, did you say that? And he said, yes. I said, you said, that's not fair. And he said, right. I said, do I recall that you didn't turn your paper in on time the last time? He said, that's right. I said, okay, if you want justice, you're going to get justice. And I wrote F for both. I said, anybody else? Anybody else want justice, ladies and gentlemen? We need to understand the difference between justice and mercy. The minute you think that God owes you mercy, a bell should go off in your brain that warns you and tells you that you're no longer thinking about mercy. For by definition, mercy is voluntary. God is never obligated to be merciful to a rebellious creature. He doesn't owe you mercy. As he has said, I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy. And I'll close with this. A holy God is both just and merciful, never unjust. There is never an occasion in any page of sacred scripture where God ever punishes an innocent person. God simply doesn't know how to be unjust. I thank him every night that he does know how to be non-just. Because mercy is non-justice, but it is not injustice. And so I'll leave you with this. When you say your prayers, don't ever ask God to give you justice. He might do it. And if God were to deal with us according to justice, we would perish as swiftly as Nadab and Abihu and Uzzah and Ananias and Sapphira in the New Testament. But we live, beloved, by grace, by his mercy. And let's never forget it. Let's pray. Our Father, forgive us for presuming upon your loving kindness, for demanding it, for being angry when we don't receive it. Oh, Father, help us to be amazed by grace, for we ask it in the name of Christ. Amen.
For more information about Dr. R.C. Sproul and Ligonier Ministries, call 1-800-435-4343. In Florida, 407-834-1633. Or write P.O. Box 7500, Orlando, Florida, 32854. Resource catalogs featuring additional video series, audio cassettes, curriculum, and books are available.